Dear colleagues, dear friends, it's my extreme pleasure to communicate you some work, recent developments, and some thoughts and considerations with regard to the task which makes relevant this talk for the this session related to the space exploration. So it's called, as you can see, it's a lifetime radiation risk of stochastic effects, prospective evaluation for space flight or medicine. And this is work presented, work of several authors. You can see them, as well as you can see the general disclaimer saying that this is just the author's point of view and neither approved nor endorsed by IAEA or ICRP. So why do we need projecting radiation risks? Because you know of late stochastic detrimental effects of radiation, malignant neoplasms are in focus, and we need to project risks for them into the future to assess to know probability of radiation attributable diseases or of mortality or other outcomes of interest. And also it's worth mentioning that the modern system of radiation protection depends on this time-integrated estimates of risk, for example, because the definition of effective dose is based on the detriment-adjusted nominal risk coefficients for stochastic effects, which are calculated using this risk matrix, these quantities. So from conventional risk matrix, the first one to mention is a well-known and widely spread lifetime attributable risk, which is, you know this equation, and I'm not going to frighten everybody with going details in the mathematics and so on, but just to indicate that this quantity calculated using the certain demographic and health statistics data. It needs survival function for the general population, which is demographic, and it needs the incidence rate for exposed and non-exposed populations. So the effect is expressed as a difference between two groups of population. And if we replace the integration not until the full lifetime, but to the certain age, then we call it just the attributable risk. Another conventional metric for risk, which was already was mentioned today in Mark Shaver's talk, this is risk of exposure-induced cancer or exposure-induced death. And this quantity was introduced because it acknowledges explicitly that the exposure to radiation creates additional hazards which may reduce the survival in the exposed population. So this quantity was introduced and it uses in calculation of the attributable risk survival curve for the exposed population. Another quantity which was introduced more than, I think, more than 20 years ago in wide circulation, it's an excess lifetime risk. And this is defined as a difference of the losses due to outcome of interest in the exposed and non-exposed identical populations. And this is most difficult to, calculate because it includes, it depends both on the health statistics for exposed and unexposed population. It depends on the demographic for exposed and unexposed population. And of course, if the statistics and demographic data for non-exposed general population we can look and find in the data, the same quantities for exposed population need to be assessed, calculated, and somehow evaluated. So what is common for this all conventional risk metrics is that they express radiation risk, radiation attributable risk, using the cumulative losses or failures expressed as a fraction of population alive and free of outcome of interest at the time of exposure. This fraction, when you apply it to the population, it tells you about the probability for a member of population to develop the radiation attributed outcome at certain age or during lifetime, provided conditional on the assumption that the time dependence of survival chances and incidence rates, which you use in calculations, do not depend or do not change in future. And of course, computation of these accumulated losses, it certainly requires some additional data, demographic and health statistics, which again, commonly available for the countrywide large populations, but not for the special groups, not for the individuals, not for the groups of interest, like astronauts. So it means that the conventionally used and widely spread risk metrics have certain limitations which are inherent due to their definition. For example, the attributable risk is low-dose linear approximation. So when it's applied in situation of higher doses, it becomes implausible. I will show this later. When you apply rake or RAID, this means that you implicitly assume the same baseline incidence rates in the exposed and non-exposed population. And again, I will give you some example to show that it's not necessarily true in the situation of higher dose, exposure to higher doses. Excess risk is a very reasonable quantity, clean and understandable, but it's complex in computation, and again, it depends on survival reduction in the exposed population, which is need to be inferred or somehow estimated. All three metrics depend on health and population statistics data, which are available for contemporary general population, which is a cross-sectional data for the given period, for the given time, year, but not for the generations. That's why we can hardly deduce the secular trend of the development using the contemporary statistics, cross-sectional statistics. And correspondingly, it means that it's difficult to use these metrics to project risk over decades or apply these risk metrics for atypical populations or groups, like medical patients or astronauts. One example, if you come to the consider situation of the high exposure to higher doses, doses which already affect some survival chances, which already create significant hazard, then you will see that in the given population, on the left, we have unexposed population. Suppose you have some outcomes of spontaneous cancer and some non-cancer outcomes, but exposure will create additional hazard, and this additional hazard will reduce the probability for manifestation for spontaneous cancer, so which is a baseline, and non-cancer, which are competing risks for the population survival. Another example is difficulty of the conventional risk metrics is so-called radiotherapy paradox. It means that if you look and try to assess the late risk of radiotherapy, then the best radiotherapy, which maximizes survival chances, will result in the highest risks, radiation-attributed risks of late effects. So it means that it becomes not very practical, not very useful in the clinical practice. So what could be alternative? Alternative could be just to think about, again, if we consider population, if we consider the situation of radiation exposure, which creates additional hazard, it means that this additional hazard results in the reduction of survival chances. So if we have the population with this fraction surviving at the age of exposure E, and without exposure, normal population will survive until this quantity, which corresponds to the age of interest A, then the radiation exposure results in reducing this fraction. So we can say that now the effect of radiation can be expressed as a fraction of population initially alive and free of disease at the time of exposure, which will be lost due to this radiation exposure. But again, this fraction can be expressed as a part of the survival fraction at the age of interest, times the sum factor which expresses effect of radiation exposure. So then we say, look, okay, if we will consider situation conditional upon survival to the age A, and we'll take the pure net effect of radiation exposure, pure net detrimental effect of it, Then we come to the alternative concept, which we termed radiation-attributed reduction of survival, but which is well known for decades in statistical literature and called as a cumulative risk, and it was introduced in the literature on cancer epidemiology and radiation risk more than 20 years ago in publications of IARC. So it's, we just suggested this term to for practical purposes. If anybody would suggest a better one, we can talk and consider. So this quantity, not similar to the conventional risk matrix, it represents radiation-attributed risk as a reduction factor to the chances to survive at a certain age. That is a fraction of non-exposed population which would not survive outcome-free beyond the given age. So, due to the definition, by definition, this quantity is insensitive to competing risk which may exist in the group of interest or in the population of interest. And therefore, it will coincide with the conventional metrics when the survival is affected only by outcome of interest, only by radiation-attributed outcome of interest. It means no competing risk in the population. Here is some examples. Consider how they compare to each other RADS and the conventional risk matrix and the situation which can be characterized like exposure to high dose and for the outcome of interest, which is a composite of solid cancers with a high incidence rate. And then we, here is just exemplary calculations, not for the astronaut, because there is some purpose to make it specifically for this case. It's a young female, 10-year, exposed at age 10 to high dose 3 gray. And then you see that the all metrics, starting from the attributable risk, rake, excess risk, and RADS, they behave quite similar until the person reaches the age when the competing non-radiation attributing risk reduces survival chances. And then after that, they become behave differently. So, what is important to show here that the attributable risk becomes, for this situation, more than 100%. So it explicitly indicates that the LAR is a low-dose linear approximation which becomes simply invalid at the exposure at high doses which may appear. Other metrics quite similar, although rake, of course, based on the assumption the same baseline rates and exposed non-exposed population behaves a bit differently from the excess risk. And red line represents this quantity, which is a RADS, which is free from any competing risk effect, so which is a maximum here. Another example, just opposite, low dose exposure, low incidence outcomes, for example, thyroid cancer in children. Again, 10-year-old female exposed to dose 100 milligray, and you see that practically no difference between all four risk metrics. Of course, again, because the RADS is free from any effect of competing risks at ages after 70, it remains, represents pure radiation effect, and the all other metrics behaves absolutely similar way because there is no reason for them to deviate to each other. So quickly, summary, what are the advantages of using the RADS? There is no effect of competing risk of survival and incidence rate and the time-integrated risk. RADS renders only model radiation risk. That means no uncertainty due to unknown secular trends of incidence and survival, screening effects, or whatever. RADS is suitable to express radiation-attributed risk for atypical groups, like medical patients, astronauts, occupationally exposed persons. Of course, it has its specificity, and one should remember that this is not a universal answer to all questions in radiation protection. It renders risk projection conditional on our risk model we use, using the model estimated excess incidence rate. And model is developed based on a certain epidemiological study, and as such, it's defined within the certain parameter domain. If we apply our model beyond the domain, it means extrapolation. And extrapolation, you know, it's always quite a dangerous process, and that's why extrapolation requires caution. One has to use only robust radiation risk models, and which means that the parameters, especially time-dependent parameters or age-dependent parameters, must be highly statistically significant and robust. Also, as a survival modifying factor, RADS has no sense beyond the population lifetime. So it means that, say, lifetime RADS is impossible because no such quantity exists by definition. So now coming to the conclusions, what we can say, that the radiation risk projections based on conventional risk metrics may render implausible for long-term risk projections for atypical groups or individuals, medical patients, astronauts, other persons, or in cases of strong competing risks. For example, high dose exposure, medical treatment, occupational risk, lifestyle, other causes, other reasons. Alternative quantity RADS can be considered as a complementary risk estimate useful for communicating radiation risks due to the inherent independence on competing risks. And if you want to get more ideas and to go to the details, because you see this talk was just a quite a overview, review, and so I'm really curious if you would try and to find out this QR code works to provide you with additional information. Does it? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Alexander. Okay. So one of the questions, oh, there's a couple questions. You don't get away that easily. Yeah.
That's a pleasure.
It's some magic on the app. And if people want to go to the microphones as well, they're welcome to. But can you describe the difference between RADS, R-A-D-S, and READ, R-E-I-D?
Yes. RID is similar to LAR and excess risk, and it expresses as a difference between exposed and non-exposed population. No, not fully correct. It's excess risk. But the RADS expresses excess rate for exposed population. And in this sense, it assumes implicitly that the baseline rates in the exposed and non-exposed population must be the same. It's correct for low doses. It's incorrect for the higher doses and higher incidence rate. And as I showed you with this qualitative example, when the radiation creates significant hazard, this significant hazard to manifest itself, to become outcome in the population, will unavoidably reduce the outcomes of competing risks. That's why how they work, this, how they compete. So that's it. But the RADS is insensitive by definition. It's a pure effect of radiation effect, which is we derived from our risk model. So it's only our inference, risk inference, our belief based on our epidemiological study. And no influence by the population statistics, no influence by the survival chances, how they will develop in future. This is, doesn't intervene in the calculations.
Thank you. One other question I'm just making up myself because I have the mic. If you were to compute a RADS value for an astronaut or a patient, and you showed it to them, how do you explain what it means?
That's a very good question. It's quite an unusual way to look at things. And we, frankly speaking, we also spent a lot of time trying to understand what does it mean. But in principle, as I said, we can. I will ask you another question. How would you communicate to the individual or astronaut what does it mean lifetime attributable risk? Does it mean it's a risk for the last member of the population who lives the maximum survival?
You can answer the question.
Okay, sorry. It's against rule. Yeah. So it means that, indeed, this shows the picture from other side. The conventional metrics report you the probability in terms of failures you will develop from exposure to certain time, age or lifetime. This tells you another story. It tells you if you would not be exposed, you would have some chances to live beyond the age 60. But the exposure would reduce these chances, whatever these chances are, by say 25% or by 5% or by 1%. This would tell you some influence, impact of radiation on your further life. That would be a way to communicate this. I don't know whether it's successful. I invite everybody to suggest a better way to communicate, because indeed it's not a very easy issue to do. I agree, fully agree with this.
Good, thank you very much. Does anyone else want to ask a question through the microphone? Please, there's a microphone just behind you.
The question was from me, this is red and red. Can we use as a rule of thumb, LAR, for low dose secondary cancer incidence for pediatric patients, and REID for astronauts? The RADs from the survival.
No.
And REID for induced radiation induced death.
Moment. We speak about the incidence rate of outcome of interest, just to make a general picture. Of course, if you are interested in the cancer development, then you should work with the incidence rates, and you should work with the cancer-free survival, so modified survival curves. This is a technical issue, we can discuss it later. But if you use, you say, if you're interested in the mortality, then you probably should make your calculations with the mortality rates and the survival only, because survival by definition defined using mortality rates. So these are technical issues. But the rate and rake, these are identical quantities, but they just look for the different outcomes, incidence of disease and mortality from this disease. But because the cure rates are different and the survival curve for different types of cancer are different, these two quantities are different when you apply it to the specific task, when you calculate using these quantities. And this also the cure rates, they are not constant. If you look, for the example, for the breast cancer therapy, 30 years ago, you would see the one survival. In last decade, you would get statistical data which show you that the survival, mean survival, increased. So it means that the time between incidence, clinical diagnosis of the disease, and the death from this cause, this time changes. But which data you would like to use if you propagate from now to 50 years ahead? You would use current contemporary data, today's data, but no guarantee this data will be correct in 20 years.
Thank you, sir.
Very briefly, go ahead, Kimberly.
Yeah, very brief, just a comment about the use of secondary cancers. I think the new term that is preferred is second primary cancers. Because of attribution, we do not know that there are secondary cancers from radiation or from chemotherapy. And so the National Cancer Institute is very strongly asking us all, this community, to say second primary cancer. It's language that we want to use.
Absolutely.
So thank you.
Thanks for the reminder. Very good. So thank you very much, Alexander. Now you're free. It's okay.